Elena Bellina is assistant professor of Italian at the Eastman School of Music of the University of Rochester. Her research and publications focus on war and captivity studies, autobiographical writing, music, and gender studies. She is currently working on Creativity on Stage Behind Barbed Wire, Italian Prisoners of War in Africa, a book manuscript investigating how World War II Italian prisoners in Kenya escaped the trauma of captivity through the performing arts and the sciences. And she's co-editing with Georgia Alou, Captivity and Creativity, the Cultural and Material Production of Italian Prisoners in Western Allied Countries in World War II. She's also completing African Adventures, Palmiro Forzini in East Africa, 1936 to 1946, a critical edition and English translation of a two-volume unpublished POW memoir. In 2019, she was a Lauro De Bossis Fellow in the History of Modern Italy at Harvard University. And the title of her presentation is Crafting New Italian Landscapes in Captivity, Italian Prisoners of War in Kenya and South Africa During World War II.
So as you can read from my presentation, I focus especially on Italian prisoners of war in Africa, especially in East Africa and South Africa for this presentation between 1940 and 1947. And as you see from this first slide, which is a watercolor painted by Felice Benuzzi, probably the better known of these POWs detaining Kenya between 1940 and 1947, it's very interesting because as he was climbing Mount Kenya, he took the time to draw landscapes and then to turn them into watercolors for his diaries that he wrote as he was climbing Mount Kenya. And as you can see from this watercolor, it's not just the landscape, but there are two characters in the watercolor. You see the shade of his shadows, because he's painting, and his peer, POW, Giovanni, or El Juan, with whom he climbed the mountain. So there's a present. These are subjects of this new landscape. They are trying to conquer it. They are trying to be part of it. And that will be a constant in his relationship with this new landscape. And just to start my presentation, this is another drawing taken from another diary, an unpublished diary by Vincenzo Marini, Prigionia, 1941-1944. That I found at the Brooklyn College Library, the Robert Hess collection, where you get a sense about the complex captivity that characterized the Italian prisoners of war history during the Second World War, because they were transferred from and across at least four or five different continents. Often captured in North or East Africa, they were transferred to India, South Africa, Australia, North America, and back to Europe and the UK. So between 1940 and 1946-47, more than 600,000 Italian servicemen were captured by the Western Allied forces in the Mediterranean region and in East Africa and transferred to five different continents. Italian prisoners of war were scattered across many parts of Africa, North America, Australia, India, and the United Kingdom, where they were usually employed as an expensive workforce in many economic activities, especially after September 1943. While farming in Africa and in the UK, working in sugarcane plantations in Australia, mapping the Himalayan region in India, building churches, schools, roads, and bridges in the UK and South Africa, or playing music and working archaeological sites in East Africa, Italian POWs learn how to relate to the new natural environments, adapting by making them look closer to the Italian countryside and mountains they had left behind. Italian prisoners easily adapted their farming knowledge and technical skills to these regions, while learning from native populations about the new climates, ecosystems, and animal species. Besides growing tomatoes and building pasta machines with discarded truck engine parts, Italian prisoners of war dotted many regions with monuments, churches, theaters, and statues during their long captivity. Some of these sites are now preserved as historical landmarks, especially in Kenya. Today, I intend to briefly discuss with you some of the different ways the over 150,000 Italian POWs that passed through temporary or permanent internment camps, especially in Kenya and partly in South Africa, between 1941 and 47, moved across these lands and interacted with them, thus creating unexpected eco-Italian landscapes that give testimony to an important historical presence that is to this day very understudied. I will devote particular attention to the POWs kept in the Rift Valley in Kenya and their relationship with Mount Kenya. And I will say a couple of words and show you some images of the Transvaal province in South Africa, where there was the camp, the Zonderwater POW camp, where more than 100,000 men were detained, or through which more than 50,000 passed as they were moved from Africa to the other continents. Just to give you, as usual, an idea, I don't know how much you know about Italian captivity during World War II, but during World War II, 1.2 million Italian men were captured, and half of them were in German hands, the other half in Allied hands. And of the 600,000 prisoners in Allied hands, about 468,000 were in British hands, and the Americans held the other 125,000. 51,000 of these were sent to the US, and the rest was first kept in North Africa and then from there brought back to Europe, especially to France and to Germany. With these numbers in mind, you have to keep in mind that, let me move here, this is just a summary taken from Bob Moore and Ken Fedorovich with most of the numbers here of the ones that permanently interned in this camp. This doesn't take into account the other men who were constantly shifted from especially North and East Africa to the rest of the world. In 1940, 1941, the colossal British victory over the Italian troops in North Africa and East Africa caught the British forces unprepared. Between June and September of 1940, the British Army captured about 133,000 Italian soldiers in North Africa, while Abyssinia and Italia Somaliland together yielded another 64,000 captives in early 1941. British and colonial authorities had to build large detention camps with very limited resources in no time. In 4 months between April and July of 1941, Kenya and Sudan built 24 camps to host the Italian prisoners that would be mostly sent to the Horn of Africa. In an attempt to respond to the emergency, British and colonial authorities resorted to POWs, to POW labor to erect these barracks and these camps. And as the situation of the African front became more critical in September of 1943 after the armistice, after the Italian armistice, when a total of 500,000 Italian soldiers were taken prisoners by the Allies and kept in Africa. Most of these men did not return to Italy until the end of 1946 or 1947, after many peregrinations across Africa, India, North America, Australia, and Great Britain. Let's take, for instance, the map that I showed you before by Vincenzo Marini. He inserted several maps in his handwritten diary titled Prigionia. An Italian cavalry captain who worked as liaison officer to General Gazzera, Marini was captured in East Africa in June 1941 and remained a POW until 1944. As you can see from the map he drew in his diary, during those 4 years he was relocated in three different continents, from East Africa to India, from India to South Africa, and from there to the United States, where he was moved from New York to Tennessee and Arkansas, and then back to Naples via North Africa. And here there is a second part, the detailed map about when he was captured and how he was moved from Gambela and Ambidollo up to the coast, where the prisoners would be boarded on ships and taken usually either via East Africa and South Africa or via India to the other locations, especially when the British forces didn't know where to place them in their African territories at that point. Similarly to Vincenzo Marini, Captain Mario Felli includes a detailed map and lists all the places where he was first stationed and later imprisoned in his memoir, Come ho visto un angolo d'Africa, How I Saw a Corner of Africa, followed by his closing line, and I quote, Dopo sette anni, nove mesi e qualche giorno, termina il mio safari in terra d'Africa, 1939-1946. That's how Captain Felli summarizes the 7 years he spent in East Africa, first as an officer on a cartographic mission to map Ethiopia, and between 1941 and 46 as a prisoner of war and a co-operator of war in British hands in Kenya. In 1941, Felli and more than 100,000 Italian men were officially captured and became war prisoners, or, in Felice Benuzzi's words, Captivi Vulgaris Keniensis. Felice Benuzzi, probably, as I said before, the better known among these Italian prisoners in British hands, became a sensation all over the world, especially in the Allied countries, in the Anglophone Allied countries, in 1943 for his two-week escape from POW Camp 354 in Nanyuki, Kenya, to climb Mount Kenya. He coined the term Captivus Vulgaris Keniensis in his war diary in order to describe himself and his peers, and I quote, "Captivus Vulgaris Keniensis is not a subspecies of Homo sapiens, but a superspecies. Here one finds concentrated humanity. Every character becomes saturated, concentrated, both in its better and worse aspects, to an extent that could not occur in free life," end of quote. In 1947, as you saw before, Felice Benuzzi published his POW diary in Italian as Fuga sul Kenya, 1947, in Milan, as soon as he was repatriated. The book was immediately translated into English as No Picnic on Mount Kenya, and into more than other 50 different languages, thus becoming a World War II mountaineer and captivity classic that popularized the history of Italian POWs in Kenya, especially outside of Italy. Here, in the map that I already showed you, Benuzzi, like Felli, was captured and moved to Addis Abeba in 1941, and from there moved from one detention camp to the other along the railroad connected the coast and Addis Abeba to Nairobi and Lake Victoria, passing through the Mount Kenya region, where most POW camps were located for security reasons. Like most war internment sites, Nanyuki was, and I quote from Benuzzi's diary, a vast plain with the corrugated iron roofs of hundreds of barracks. Here you see the line of the railroad that connects the coast to Lake Victoria and Uganda, and along there, especially the picture in color, you get the towns, the villages where the POW camps were located. And here, these barracks, and you can see a picture that was taken when Benuzzi was detained in Nanyuki, and it's in the first edition of his published diary, you get a view of what the camp was like, and he describes this as the barracks were made of bamboo covered in tar, ended up accommodating thousands and thousands of Italians between 1940 and 1946. And the one element that here is very relevant is the Troning Peak of Mount Kenya that remains an obsession for all the Italian prisoners interned in Kenya. The region, and you'll see more pictures here, I have plenty of pictures, so you can visualize what we are talking about. But what they could see from all these camps that were very remote in deserted areas, high up in the Rift Valley, was this gigantic mountain that they all regarded as something they wanted, something very benevolent, something protective, something they wanted to conquer. But you'll see why I'm already telling you this. As World War II progressed, Italian POWs became an indispensable cheap labor force all over the British Empire, where they were regarded as a pool which Allied governments would continue to draw on in whatever way would best serve the manpower problem and the wider war effort. POWs replaced men at war in road and railroad construction, in agriculture, and in all sorts of public and private manufacturing activities. As early as 1941, the Italian prisoners captured in East Africa were utilized above all to repair the Great North Road, the vital dirt road connecting British Central and East African colonies. Therefore, when dictator Benito Mussolini was deposed in July 1943, and Italy switched sides with the chaotic armistice of September 1943, Prime Minister Winston Churchill managed to bypass the Geneva Convention and to negotiate a verbal agreement with Prime Minister Marshal Pietro Badoglio. Churchill obtained authorization to hold on to the prisoners until the new controversial status of cooperators of war, until the crops of 1946 had been harvested all over the British territories. The 1929 Geneva Convention made no legal provision for the sudden Italian surrender of 1943, leaving millions of Italian servicemen in the midst of chaos. So as POW became a visible presence, as documented by newspaper here, this is the African Standard, the leading East African newspaper published in Kenya. To this day, it is one of the leading newspapers there. As you can see, British Italian POWs became a constant presence in pictures, in articles, through interviews. I put blue arrows pointing to the pictures on the Sunday edition of the East African Standard, where next to the announcements of wedding of the British officers or relevant authorities, you see the Italian prisoners gathered together, captured or in their camps. And to the right side, you also see how they were featured prominently in the opening pages of all these newspapers. And this is a page from the 1940. We're not yet in 1942, 43, 44, 45, when there will be more than 500,000 men in that position. But they were really visible. They were constantly talked about in newspapers, in war reports, but also they were the largest white group present in East Africa. And this is the sequence of the POW camps in East Africa that were located along the railroad. And here I'm quoting from Christine Nichols. As you can read here, biographer and historian Christine Nichols writes in her memoir about growing up in Kenya, Red Strangers, the White Tribe of Kenya. And I quote, in 1942, Kenya's white population experienced a rapid increase when 60,000 Italians from Somalia and Abyssinia were taken prisoners and sent to POW camps in Nanyuki, Nyeri, Naivasha, Jiljil, Londiani, and Nyeri. Trusted Italian prisoners were set free to work on farms. Those sent to help the claptroths at Kip Kabus took over the milk round and made beautiful inlaid furniture. The Italians quarried stones, erected farm buildings, did plumbing and electrical installation, and impressed everybody with their skill as master craftsmen. They also tarmacked the road there between Nairobi and Naivasha, over and down the Rift Valley. And I keep my quotation, but I'll show you the pictures. Near its foot, they built a tiny chapel of Thanksgiving. And here you see two of the chapels that they built that are now a historical landmark, officially approved by Kenya in 2014 as a historical landmark. And according to the prime minister who passed that law, that was an important step towards memorializing a part of modern history of Kenya that is not very known even in Kenya. So these chapels, and you see all the details, one near Ndarugu and the other one near Naivasha is the one Christine Nichols is mentioning here. So when she says that they built a tiny chapel of Thanksgiving, and then she continues, the Italians had a vast range of talents. A fine Italian orchestra gave concerts in Nairobi, and there were superb arts and crafts exhibitions. They also assisted with archaeological investigations of Louis and Mary Leakey's on the floor of the Rift Valley. The Italian were well liked by the settler. And here you see other monuments that they built. This is specifically the monument that they built halfway through the road that they quarried going up to the Rift, through the Rift Valley. It was a monument to memorialize the death of the Duke of Aosta, Amedeo, Duke of Aosta. And it had four sides with different images of the battles in which the Duke was captured. Unfortunately, this monument was discovered by Aldo Manos, a retired Italian Croatian UN officer who now lives in Nairobi, and some locals asked him if he knew anything about the many monuments around Kenya and outside of Nairobi. They took him there. So in 2014, he was able to take pictures of all of them and walk around them. Shortly after, 2 years later, there are lots of diamond caves and lots of important caves in that area. Someone destroyed the monument overnight. So these are the only pictures we're left with that memorialize what the building, the column, it's around a pass, a mountain pass was there. So these are the only pictures available. These pictures are taken from an article published by the scientific journal of the museum, the National Museum of Kenya, that published everything in 2014. And here, if we go back for a second to Captain Mario Felli's diary, Come io ho visto un angolo d'Africa, He was detained in the Eldore POW camp in Kenya, one that was very close to Nanyuki and to Burgure and to some of the harshest and the largest camps in East Africa. And he was moved around all these camps throughout his detention there. That was pretty long. I apologize about the quality of the pictures. These are the only pictures available through his manuscript at the National Diary Archive in Pieve di Santo Stefano. The family has never let me have any clear copy, so that these are copies of the photocopies available in the diary. But if you look at this picture, you will, you know, somehow see the tomato plants in front of the barracks to the picture to the right hand side, and to the other side you see the open kitchen with POWs in uniform at work. Felli, like most of his peers, kept himself busy in many ways to avoid falling into the mental annihilation imposed by captivity. He built barracks and camps. He volunteered to teach English, Italian, and geography. He was a geographer by training. He built theaters and facilities in the camp, and he organized all sorts of musical, opera, and theatrical performances that would keep all prisoners away from depressive thoughts. He grew vegetable gardens that you can see here by his barrack, built a theater and several soccer fields and tennis yards. And here there are pictures of the open space in front of the barracks that was used as a soccer field, especially on Sundays, and then in the morning it was the inspection area. But this gives you and let you visualize how the system worked within these camps and how they transformed, especially early on when they were the first prisoners to arrive there, this space into from a desertic area into a place where you could grow vegetable, you could play soccer, you could perform. They built an entire theater. So not only did Italian POWs restructure their POW camps and dotted the rocky landscape of the Rift Valley with Italian chapels, monuments, tomato plants, and soccer fields, but they also studied and documented its flora and fauna and published scientific articles about it in academic journals. These are pictures that I was able to find of an overview of the Rift Valley, so you get an idea. I've never been there. I wish I could go there. They tell me politically it's too dangerous. People who work there with the UN told me. But you have to imagine that they have to build the roads that take you all the way up to the top of the Rift Valley, and that the camps were standing on the sides of these canyons, essentially. So that it's mostly dry land. This is one of the scientific publications, Ferruccio Meneghetti, that highlighted in yellow there, was one of these Italian prisoners. He worked with the Corridor Museum, now the National Museum of Kenya, as a POW, and after the end of World War II, when he returned to Kenya to continue his work as a scientist there. Like many other POWs, he collaborated with the archaeological investigations of Louis and Mary Leakey's on the floor of the Rift Valley. And here you can see Louis and Mary Leakey's in the Rift Valley. I don't know how familiar you are with this, but these are the ones who discovered Lucy, our ancestor. And during this excavation, as early as 1941, since they were already in the sites, and the sites are located very close to the POW camps, Louis Leakey heard about the presence of the Italians there. So he knew some of these professors, especially from the University of Bologna, who were officers there, and so he asked British authorities the permission to use them and employ them in his archaeological site. Mm-hmm. This part of my research, I hope the military archive will give me permission to enter and check the folders of these prisoners. So if you are curious about who these men were, I have some names. I don't know much about them. I need one day to be able to be granted permission to see their files at the military archive. The interesting part is that in the memoir of the young person who were growing up with the children of the Leakeys, especially Christine Nichols, there are all these references to these men working with them, playing with the children, and being a constant presence next to them. Ferruccio Meneghetti and all these other men, including Felice Benuzzi, interacted with the landscape in many ways. They learned how to quarry the dirty roads along the Rift Valley, and they knew how to use the rocks there and build bricks with African dirt. They studied the edible plants and learned how to cope with infesting ants, uncovered primates' bones with the Leakeys, and built bridges. Yet, one of their main fascinations with the East African landscape remained Mount Etna. And this is another picture taken exactly from the place where the camp, the POW camp, stood. And this is a quote from Benuzzi's diary. "I do not consider the 5 years I spent as a prisoner of war as the sweetest of my life. But when all is said and done, I can at least bear witness to the difference between my mental state in the years before Mount Kenya and those years after Mount Kenya, when I was busy writing these lines." And with this image in mind here, you have to think that Italian POWs so interacted with this, and Benuzzi in his diaries, when he was taken to the Nanyuki camp, he spent the first month of his detention in 1941-42 admiring the peak of Mount Kenya, until starting from November 1942, he started to plan his climb. At night, he would sew a blanket with his prisoners and convince two of them to plan and physically train to be able to face the climbing of the mountain. Mm-hmm. And this is a description of the first time he saw Mount Kenya, and he fell in love with it. But the description that you find in his diary, because his diary is the most popular, and he wrote it, translated it in English and everything, but this description of this beautiful mountain, when he says, "A massive blue-black tooth of sheer rock inlaid with azure glaciers, austere yet floating fairy-like on the horizon. It was the first 17,000-foot peak I had ever seen. I stood gazing until the vision disappeared among the shifting cloud banks. For hours afterwards, I remained spellbound." I had definitely fallen in love. And this remained the attitude that most of these prisoners have towards the mountain. He was obsessed to the point that he kept drawing and painting the peak, and without any map, he was able to figure this out early on before planning his escape through the label of canned meat, that they were fed. But through this image, and he describes the entire process, he was able to make calculation. He was able to understand which peak was available and which one was not, where he started to draw all the animals and all the plants that he could figure out from where he was at the foot of of Mount Kenya, and to go all the way up here. And with these calculations, he figured out how long it would take to get there. Many British officers who loved hiking mountains like him had never achieved these calculations or figured out how to pass Point Lenana. In the end, he arrived there in January 1943, spent a couple of nights there, and then returned to the camp, where he was interned, of course, as punishment, but congratulated by all the prisoner, by all the British authorities. He became a celebrity, especially in the UK. This article that appeared first on the East African Standard was immediately reprinted in the Times, and then in most of the Anglophone newspapers. And of course, it arrived in Italy as well, where the celebratory image was of course, colonial soldiers conquered the peak of Mount Kenya, which was exactly the reverse situation. But it is interesting how La Tribuna Illustrata published and described the adventure there. But as they were climbing the mountain and they were arriving to this understanding, scientific knowledge of the new place they were working in and that they were inhabiting, they were also represented as something else. And as something else in Italy compared to what they had become in, especially in the Anglophone world, where of course they were very important free labor force, but they were also all these intellectual, creative Italians that they were regarded as such, and therefore were allowed to work outside of the camp. First as prisoners of war, then as cooperator of war, they had to sign an agreement. Once they accepted to renounce fascism, they would be sent to the farms, to the theaters, to different locations. And this was post 1943. Remember, Benuzzi was the only one before before the armistice who was capable of such an enterprise. So this is instead the drawing that he has of the of planting the flag on the peak of Mount Kenya. And these are this is the opening image that I use for my presentation, because one of the things that you can notice in his drawing done as he was climbing the mountain, and he's very accurate. If you're interested in this, I always recommend to read the booklet, because it's a beautiful diary and it's a beautiful adventurous diary. He always draws himself inside the picture as he details the bushes, the animals, the tent, the location of the tent, the snow, the colors of the different parts of the mountains. And it was not just his obsession. This is the official picture that circulated in the 1940s to celebrate the Amedeo Duke of Aosta when he died in one of these camps in Kenya after being captured by the British forces. This is a title of a small publication made in 1947 in Naples by some of his collaborators once they returned. It is a personal memory in honor of Duke of Aosta. In fact, the title is Addis Abeba, Nairobi con Duca d'Aosta. I took away the subtitles for respect for everybody, un fidelissimo, but I have to mention that. So it is not the most accurate, the appropriate publication, but inside there are these pictures that date to 1941-42 that are very relevant. Here you can see Amedeo Duke of Aosta standing in the Rift Valley and admiring the valley, exactly with through the same images that Felice Benuzzi and many of these POW were constantly fascinated with. They were really spent a lot of time studying them. And just a few words, and I knew I would never spend enough time on East Africa, on South Africa, and I'll wrap it up in a minute. The other very large camp, Italian POW camp in Africa, was located in Zonderwater, the land without water in Double Dutch. It's a desertic region that to these days is an area full of diamond caves. It became a city, an Italian city, with more than 100,000 prisoners of war who were detained there as per 1942-43. It was a tent village. This is what it looked like before Presburg, the South African captain that transformed the camp. It was exactly like this. It's desert, as you can see. To this day, there's no water there. But what they were able to do was this, turn the tendopoli, the tent city, into something full of plants, vegetable gardens. Of course, with the dirt, they were able to cook bricks and then turn the tent into construction, into little barracks. And with this in mind, they crafted lots of statues. You can see a St. Francis statue to the top left corner, vegetable gardens by the hospital to the right top corner, you know, a putto, a colonnade with a putto to the lower left side, a Teatro Roma. Every single POW camp had more than one theater, usually, that was constantly used for all sorts of production, especially classical music and opera production, with at least one or two symphonic orchestra. But this is the image that the Italian prisoners of war detained in Africa, and East Africa and South Africa are probably the cases that make it in a very strong way, the idea that these Italian men trained under fascism spent very often more than 5-6 years there and decided to embrace this land and apply their craft, their Italian crafts, in terms of agriculture, building new structure, adapting to the new culture. Even there are details about how they learn to slaughter zebras or other animals in a different way than they used to do at home. So they really decided to become part of these different landscape. And I stop there, and apologies if I went over time. Thank you.
So Felice Benuzzi was an alpinist. How?
Oh, yes, of course.
He was an alpinist. And from where? And did he go by himself or with other people? And how do we know he really went?
Felice Benuzzi was originally from Vienna. He was born in Vienna, raised in the Mitteleuropa, in Trieste, between Vienna and Trieste. He was a trained alpinist, as you can imagine. He was also an Olympionic athlete, and he participated in the Olympic Games in the 1930s. He was a runner, though, there. The reason why he accepted a position as a diplomat in East Africa was because he married to a Jewish Roman woman in 1937, and when Benito Mussolini passed the racial laws, he decided that it was safer to go somewhere else with his young wife, whom he met at the at La Sapienza, the university, and so they relocated to Mogadishu, and there he kept hiking. And for the expedition, yes, he did it with two other men. And we have pictures of them, even in their 60s and 70s, interviewed on national TV, on Rai, about their great adventure. All of them suffered from mal d'Africa, and they all kept talking about it for the rest of their lives. One of them went completely crazy, the doctor, one of them was a doctor, and in his 40s returned to Africa and really became mentally ill and relocated in the jungle where he died in a little hut. And it's all documented, yeah.
Thank you very much for the great presentation. I just had a question about the how much in the sources the prisoners of war, romanticize their experience retrospectively, because especially the idealization of the Duca degli Abruzzi and some of the practices that you showed us, there is this clear connection between mountaineering and colonial exploration. Essentially, that's what the Duca degli Abruzzi represented. So I wonder if it's a way for them to, as they give up their sort of their role as fascist soldiers that they can't be, because otherwise they wouldn't be free, right? Or at least they wouldn't be able to work and so on, right? Is it a way to reassert their identity as European colonizers, in a sense, if it makes sense?
Yes, it does make a lot of sense. Well, the sources are very different. If you're talking about memoirs that they wrote many decades later, is one thing, and of course they all describe it as a safari. No doubt about that, but they wrote those memoirs usually in the 1890s as they were still gathering as veterans of war and discussing and, you know, always celebrating their youth there. Remember, these were all young people in their 20s and 30s. For the diaries like Benuzzi, Benuzzi wrote it as he was climbing it. So, and not just Benuzzi, even Marini. They would, you know, these are real. And these were officers with a very specific idea about what fascism meant before and after, how they denied it at a certain point because it was the wrong way to do it. And I didn't mention Ugo Pini, who was a highly ranked officer within the fascist army in East Africa. He wrote a book, Le Ceneri dell'Impero, and published it in 1961, where he goes on and on and on discussing how wrong the whole campaign was planned, the campaign in East Africa, how poorly equipped the army was, and how he would have never done it knowing all the details he knew after he was imprisoned. Having said so, he condemned the group of POWs who didn't renounce fascism, not because he wanted to be free. The ideological problem that goes also with romanticizing or not these years in Africa, it's also a question for the highly ranked officer of where do you stand? Many of them go through pages of this, do I want my family to be killed in Italy if now I give up fascism and I know that someone, you know, will threaten them? And remember, they were in Africa before 1940. Very often they arrived there between 1936 and 1939. And they had no news from their families for years and years. Only after 1942-43, with the Red Cross, the constant checks by the Red Cross and the Vatican and authorities, they finally had a way to communicate. But being imprisoned in the desertic area north of Johannesburg or by Mount Kenya, you had very few news about that. And so it's two different groups of experiences and awareness. Most of the regular soldiers didn't even know what East Africa was. They were sent to fight the war, and when they wrote their memoir, of course, they repeated things they had said and read, but many of them also came to the conclusion, I was sent there. I was poor, my family was dying, I couldn't care less, and there I had to find a way to make it.
The next presentation is by Ilaria Serra. Ilaria Serra is a professor of Italian and Comparative Studies at Florida Atlantic University. Her research spans from Italian cinema and literature to the history of Italian immigration to the United States. Among her books are The Value of Worthless Lives, Writing Italian-American Autobiographies, and The Imagined Immigrant, Images of Italian Emigration to the United States between 1890 and 1924, and Italia Cantata, a language and culture textbook. At FAU, she coordinates the Digital Humanities Projects Italian-American Oral History Archive, Italian-American Memories, Documentary Archive, and Flora Italians. She also coordinates the FAU Italian and Italian-American Film Festivals and the annual International Symposium Italy in Transit. She founded a six-week summer study abroad program in Venice, Italy, which she has led every year since 2009. The name of her presentation is Gardening to Preserve Ancient Roots.
Thank you very much. So I'm concluding this beautiful symposium. Congratulations to the organizers and the speakers. They were all, everything was very interesting. And I think this presentation closes in a ring composition because Susan started with the garden of her father, and I'm finishing here with another garden of a colonizer plant of the vineyard of a grape vine in Venice. So this presentation focuses on a small hidden garden in a Venetian island of Sant'Erasmo. It is the secret kingdom of an early rising, bike-riding couple of aged farmers that have continued to hoe the land and watered it from their own well to keep alive a 200 years old grapevine. Their caring, ethical attitude toward the forgotten piece of land tells a bittersweet story that is salty, like the water that surrounds the vineyard, warm as the golden color of the wine, and pure as the Murano glass that holds it in a bottle made by their son. This presentation highlights the intense poetry of this old couple through their own words and through the documentary by Irene Sollazzo, some clips. Their work to protect ancient roots, physically and metaphorically, is a modern struggle against time. And it's almost a Baroque feeling, this struggle, the struggle of men against the flux of time. This is why I accompany this presentation with the details of a clock by Baroque sculptor Francesco Pianta, also carved from ancient woods, also hidden in Venice in a secret room behind the Frari convent, and also a narration of the human struggle against time. Francesco Pianta's 1600 great wooden clock represents the phases of time, astronomical time, seasonal time, and the ages of men. It's an incredible, intricate, and wonderful work. So this, you can see here the entire clock, and now I will just zoom in certain details, and you see Gastone touching with love his plants and the Murano glass bottle that the children made for them. So Venice, this is for the context, is undergoing one of its most important epochal changes, a change that is threatening its continuation, its thread of time. The ancient city is suffering from the backlash of human mistreatment of nature. The tide swallowed it on November 12, 2019, just 2 years ago, 3 years ago. The coronavirus epidemic stopped all kind of visitors from coming to the city. And for almost 2 years, Venice was a ghost town. The epidemic showed a weak side of progress and capitalist interest. When no tourists filled its calli, the bones of the city became visible. The city was a skeleton of itself. The citizens had been already driven out by the myopic politics that favored the monoculture of tourism. There are no homes in Venice but Airbnbs. There are no fish vendors but mask and glass vendors. No citizens but passerbys. And once they are gone, it became evident there was no one in the city who stayed to take care of it. Not only because they were locked inside the houses, like in other towns in Italy, but because they were just not there. Time had stopped in Venice as it stopped in Pompeii. So it's consoling to know that there is one island that resisted the corrosion of time with a plant that is a survivor. These two gardeners are Daria Lavio and Gastone Finotello, and their vineyard is in the island of Sant'Erasmo, where they cultivate the Dorona grapes. The Dorona is a survivor plant. It survived the epidemic of phylloxera in the mid-1800s and continued to grow on their footing. It's a piede franco. That means that it's still there where it was. The foot is still in the same land as where it was born.
At that time, all European vines were grafted on roots coming from the Americas that were immune to the disease of phylloxera. So only in this little area, the vines were not killed. And one of them was exactly here in the patch of the Venetian lagoon because it was salty. The terrain is salty and the bacteria, the parasite, didn't live in it. So, and again, in 1966, another surviving moment. The Great Flood killed all the grapes of the Venetian area, and Gastone's plants were the only ones that survived by destiny, and he gave them to the other farmers. So now everybody's saying, we have the real wine from Venice, but he actually had the real wine from Venice. He gave it to the other ones. He maintained the flux of time flowing against every interruption. And every summer, the garden keepers, Dariella and Gastone, welcome our students in their vineyard to enjoy homemade wine, bread cheese, salami, the zaetti cookies that they make. It is one of the highlights of our program. But this is not a presentation about an agrarian gem or a tourist attraction. I want to focus on the philosophical aspect of their gardening. The garden is an intellectual as well as material creation, says Santiago Beruete. Gastone is a gardener philosopher, as Francesco Pianta was a sculpture philosopher. And Gastone, who lives the garden as a utopia and a moral ethical place. These are words by Beruete regarding gardening. Speaking with Gastone about his work, it is impossible not to notice the rhetoric of care. It is their care that has the power to keep the time going. The philosophy of care, or filosofia della cura, is essential to for human life, affirms the philosopher Luigina Mortari. To shape our possible being, we need to take care of us and others and of the world. We are what we do and the care we give. Taking care of life preserves it in time, makes it bloom, and heals the wounds of being. The epidemic years have shown that Venice has no one to take care of it, so no wounds are healed. Caring, prendersi cura, is one of the lessons of the garden that Gastone keeps alive. This silver-haired couple is an example of the farmer's humble generosity and Venetian hospitality. They exude the energy and the ethics of hard work. They wake up at dawn in their island of Murano, which is a neighboring island. They take the public boat. They arrive in San Erasmo, they pick up their bicycles, they ride to the piece of land. This is at 5 a.m. Gastone has tight muscles and hard fingers like the branches of his vine. Dariella has the contagious smile of a florid, happy housewife. I collected their words over the years, and some have been recorded by the sensitive documentarist Irene Sollazzo. And they are in Eclipse, in this website that she has. She's a Sicilian freelance video maker. And she edits Oro della Laguna and dedicates the episode La Laguna Color del Vino, the lagoon color, color of the wine, to Gastone's work. And these clips are part of a longer documentary that she finished in 2016. And I will use them just a little bit as trellises on which to tie the branches of my presentation. So first of all, the time of silence. First, silence is an important element in the rhetoric of care. Irene's video wisely documented it. Crowds and noise that we are used to in Venice, the products of mass tourism, have no place here. The lagoon is silent in its outskirts. There is no need for chatting while working the land. There is only the silent conversation with nature and with work gestures. So silence is necessary to hear the voice of nature, according to Gastone, and we will know why soon. So see the first fragment here of Irene's video to savor this silence.
Thank you.
Okay, second, the past and the future. The tie. Gastone participates in a utopian vision. His gaze is not locked to the ground while he's bent down in the fatigue of hoeing or gardening. He raises his eyes and imagines an ideal. As Adriana Bonavia Giorgetti maintains in her L'arte di coltivare l'orto e se stessi, the dimension of the dream is fundamental when planting a garden. One has to dream it by moving inside it, raising memories of other cultivations, gathering unexpressed aspirations, and welcoming the suggestion of the place, its feeling, and its culture. And I emphasize the two words, memories and aspirations, because this is exactly what Gastone does. He connects the past and the future, and does so with a dialogue with the local place, the suggestion, the feelings of the place itself, the genius loci. Il genio del luogo. So here we should listen how he explains it. What his dream is, that record next to the past,
però
the Roman
se,
past.
Se riesco, vorrei fare come una volta che ogni orto ha il suo filare di vite. E gli altri, diciamo, e costai, questi qui. Sto costruendo una costada che va fino in fondo là, alla vecchia maniera. Come che lavoravano i vecchi, ma proprio qui. Però qui a Sant'Erasmo, dopo fuori, non so come che lavoravano, ma qui lavoravano così.
So he's saying that he wants to make a border of old wines, like in the Roman times, and this is his dream, because that's how they did it in this place. I don't know where everywhere else, but in this place they did this. He's very, very defensive of the place. Gastone makes wine like the Romans, he says, because wine is something sacred. Il vino è qualcosa di sacro. His idea of winemaking is pure. He does not use anything artificial or chemical, far from him. His storage is underground. He buries the wine underground and he covers it with leaves, so even primitive. He only uses autochthon yeasts. He does not control the temperature, he just knows it. No gauges, no thermometers. Gastone's care includes a sensorial experience. The sense of taste, he says, I taste every grape to understand where the sweet grape starts. And he does with his wife, every bunch of grapes they taste. And then he also closely observes each grape to understand when to bottle it. He says, once the wine is stored in the vat, he keeps a dialogue with his senses through his nose and his ears. I smell the wine every hour. I check it every day. I check that the tannin level is not too high. I listen to the noise of the yeast that works. And if I don't hear it after a few minutes, I get worried. So it's all human-based. Patience and respect, that's another of the dimension of his philosophy. Choosing quality over quantity also means respecting the life rhythm of the plants. Gastone does not hasten production. Young farmers want everything and now, he says. But this way we lose what is ours from these islands, he says. Gastone says, I never cut the small roots. Other farmers cut around the roots to force the plant to grow faster. So she produces more, but she dies sooner. She gets tired. It is necessary to let her rest every year. If she produces a lot, I cut it back a lot, so she has more time to rest. Time and patience are necessary. Knowing nature, not forcing it. So that's important. And you already heard this she, the plant. The aspect of personification is very important. These plants become people. The poetic of rhetorical figure of personification is present in Gastone's speech. The garden and its inhabitants are his friends. They speak to him. So he says, the wine speaks to the vine, who is the mother. The gardener is only eavesdropping in their conversation and getting his clues from what he hears. He thus knows where to bottle the wine. When the mother vine is pushing out her new buds, then the wine hears it. Hears that the vine is alive and moving. That's the right moment, no sooner, no later. If you wait longer, the vine will lose its sugar content because the wine hears the vineyard, the vine and the vineyard call each other. The wine feels that it's time to gather strength and be born again in spring. So it follows that when the vine dies, he feels it as a family member had died. He cries when the plants die. He dice, a me quando muore una vite piango perché mi dispiace, perché è vecchia, perché l'ho rancurata per anni e perché questa è nata qui. I translated it there. I cry when one dies because she was old and she was born here. And yes, and here there is one last video.
Perché questa è nata. Quelle che portano il calmo non sono nate qui.
So it's very important that he that we hear his voice. Still, in the fight against time, Gastone senses his defeat. He worries terribly that he won't find a young gardener to substitute him. The garden of Sant'Erasmus shared the same shaky destiny as the whole city of Venice. The gardener is hairless, and the city is without care. It is hard to keep the grapevines alive, he says. And his hopes are dwindling because the work entails sacrifice, which is not a popular aspect for the young generation, he says. If there is no hope, there is no future. So I end with this detail of Pianta's maturity quadrant. And if you see there, that's a joke, a Baroque joke of some kind of wink. Under the feet of the warrior of maturity, there is the face almost buried in the ground. The demis is close. This is the quadrant of maturity, exactly. Ripeness, autumn, the time that already senses and imagines death. The same feelings of ending that pervades Gastone's vineyard.
There are a couple of things that jumped out at me. One was the sort of obsessive aspect, you know, like to have that discipline of every day going. And I don't know if anyone saw the documentary, what was it called? My Octopus Teacher?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It reminded me of that, like to have that. To
That's
be so
care.
Fixated, but it was similar too because it was a relationship with something else, right? Like with nature, with a natural being of a different sort.
Yeah.
But that's really rare. It really is kind of an obsession, you know, not mm-hmm. in a negative sense. And just to tie it back with my father's garden, his attitude towards plants was he in a very simple way. I mean, he just thought of them as so important, and he would say. If he saw that you were mistreating a plant, he would say, people shouldn't be allowed to have a plant if they're going to treat it that way. Almost as though it were a human or a beloved pet, you know? So it's just interesting that perspective, even in someone who is not philosophical, you know, just that kind of feeling about plants.
Yep.
So
thank you.
That was beautiful.
Definitely. And there are not many people who can follow him after this. So that's why we already sense that. Who knows how long the Dorona wine still will live?
So how's the wine?
It's good. I even like it. Which I don't like wine, but that one I like. Yes, it's very good. It's light.
If you can't drink it,
not too much alcohol. It's good. Yes.
Thank you for that. That was really beautiful and really evocative. And I guess it's sort of a comment / question that I'm thinking about really all of the presentations about gardening and also the documentary we saw about the fig tree on Thursday evening, for those who are here, you know, it's really jumping out at me. There's a sense of gardening as resistance seems mm-hmm. to be kind of one of the themes that are coming here.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, the idea of your family there, you know, very consciously, you know, resisting certain trends both that Venice is facing and trends in farming, and certainly the resistance of a prisoner of war planting tomato plants or the kind of, mm-hmm. You know, the resistance that comes with a diasporic experience of immigration. So I'm wondering if any of the three of you have any reflections on that, particularly as we're thinking about sort of, I mean, just the adversities of the environment and the moment that we're in now and what role gardening sort of might play.
You hit the point, because in fact he is also included in one of the documentaries called Veneziani Resistenti. So the resistant Venetians who are fighting against
destruction of their city. It's becoming somebody else's city, not their city anymore. So he is included there, and it's interesting because the clip that is with him, we have these young gardeners who have tried to create another garden close by his. So he gave them all the tools, all the secrets. They resisted 3 years, now they're gone. So in the documentary, they're still there. So I know now that they're not there anymore. And in the documentary, they give him, they are very proud, and they say, oh, you gave us so much, Gastone, now we're going to give you a gift, a plant of cren. He couldn't have anything worse than that. Oh, this is not from here. It's in the documentary. no, well, we'll see what we do. And he's like disgusted by the plant of cren that doesn't belong to the Venetian islands. So he's resisting in that sense. Very good, yes. And the immigrants have the same feeling, for
exactly.
Sure. Yeah.
He doesn't want me.
I just wanted to say it also, what you said also links with the restanza idea,
uh-huh.
Right? Of staying, resisting by staying,
yes,
in one
right.
place and not leaving and not running away. Even though obviously for immigrants that's a different reality, but that's interesting too.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it's so good. It ties to back together to many things that have been said. Good. Thank you very much.